Hi, my name is Vivek Singhal. Today I'll present a webinar on regression techniques, which is a critical area of machine learning, which falls under artificial intelligence. I am a co-founder and chief data scientist with Self-Track. We are an AI startup out of Bengaluru, India, and we do training and research for AI solutions. We have students and researchers from across the world. We have meetups and webinars like this every week. Okay, so let's keep going here. So just a plug on our startup Self-Track. We are a AI startup out of India, and we are involved in AI training and deep research. I run something called Self-Track AI Lab, which is perhaps one of the leading AI research labs, at least in India today. We have almost 70 researchers in our AI lab from across the world who are working on cutting edge research in emerging AI algorithms in computer vision, NLP, reinforcement learning, driverless cars, quantum computing now, and so on and so forth. We produce a lot of content in AI, and you can find all of our public webinars on our public YouTube channel and also on our blogging website. We are very active in global AI communities online and social media. Let me continue. So this is me, your presenter for today. I have 24 years experience with 16 years in the US, and last 6 years I am here in Bengaluru, India. I used to work for IBM here. The last 5 years I have been trying multiple startups. So Self-Track is my most recent startup, and we deal with AI consulting, AI training, and AI research. Okay, and I personally am a data scientist, and I am working on multiple algorithms in this space, for example, computer vision, NLP, reinforcement learning, and so on. And you can find some of our content on a research blog, and we produce a lot of content and evangelism around AI and machine learning. Okay, let me continue here. So let me come to the topic for the day, and I assume that you have some basic idea about machine learning. Even if you don't have, just listen in. Hopefully you'll be able to appreciate this content. Basically machine learning is applied maths. Okay, so it involves a set of mathematical algorithms through which we train models which can help us do predictions. Okay, so that's primarily what ML does, and that's how we train artificial intelligence. All right, so let's look at regression, which is one of the most common techniques in machine learning, the other one being classification, by the way. So that we'll cover in the next webinar. Today we'll cover regression. So ML has two primary algorithms, regression and classification, and today we'll cover regression. So in regression, what happens, we are given these sample data points. So these blue dots which you see here, these are sample data provided to me. Let's consider house price regression. So these are so X represents the factors which influence house price, such as the size of the house, right? Size of the house, the age of the house, right? Let's assume a city like London. So this is house price regression for city of London. So size of the house, age of the house, right? So this is historical house price. Y represents the price of the house, correct? So if we consider it that way, and then we are given lots of samples, right? So each dot represents an XY data sample, right? So this is coordinate geometry. And so we are finding the equation of the red line here, okay? So this equation could look like something like this. Y is equal to 3x1 plus 4x2, some random number I'm putting here, plus something called bias, okay, B. So this B represents the y-intercept, as we know from linear algebra. So B is the value of y when x is 0. So if this is 0 and this is 0, y is simply equal to B. So B is the y-intercept. X1 represents the size, x2 represents the age of the house, and B represents the y-intercept. So this equation is the equation of this red line. So when I say we are doing regression modeling, what we really mean is we are trying to find the equation of this line which satisfy the blue dots. Okay, What is the advantage of doing this? If you are able to find the equation of this line, then using this equation, we can predict future house prices, right? So if a new house gets constructed in London, so I just need its size and age of the house, and I'll be able to predict the output Y, the price of the house, right? So you can now extrapolate this use case to so many other situations. For example, you know, how much will it rain tomorrow, right? How much will it rain tomorrow? What should be the performance rating of employee XYZ? So one has to be careful here. So let's consider this use case employee rating system. So let's say a company rewards, you know, 5 possible ratings from a scale of 1 to 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So and any employee can get 5 possible ratings. Okay, yeah, there's a question here. I'll come to that shortly. So let's say a company can award only 5 possible ratings to an employee. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we have to rate an employee on into one of these classes. This is not regression. This is what we call as classification, because there are 5 distinct classes which the employee can be assigned to. So this is classification, is the other kind of machine learning algorithm. Okay. But however, if the employee rating can be in decimals, let's say 1.1, 1.2, and so on, 2.5. If it is a contiguous figure like that, 4.8, right? So if it is a contiguous distribution, then we might resort to regression. Because you can see in this chart here that this line is representing a contiguous distribution, right? If there were only 5 possible output classes, I would resort to classification. If there's a contiguous data distribution, I will resort to what we call as regression, which we are discussing here, okay? I hope that the difference between regression and classification is very clear, okay? So we have to look at the use case, the problem statement, to determine, do we have to apply a classification algorithm or do we have to apply a regression algorithm, okay? Let me use a blue pen color, which I always prefer. Okay, that's better. Yeah, this is better. Okay, so so we understood classification versus regression. A question came, but this chart only shows feature X. What about if there are 2 features, age and size of the house? Guess what? This chart is showing it in a simplistic manner. In reality, if there are 2 features, it's a 3-dimensional chart. Okay, so on a piece of paper, it's hard to visualize 3-dimensional, you know, chart, right? But we can imagine it. So there is height, there is, you know, horizontal, there is also a depth, a third dimension going inside the paper perhaps. So this x1 would represent age of the house, x2 would represent size of the house, right? And y would represent the price. Now you might ask me, what if there are 4 features which represent house prices? Well, if there are 4 features, it will be a 5-dimensional chart, which I cannot show you clearly on a paper. There will be 4 dimensions, x1, x2, x3, x4, and finally the y. So x are called independent variable. This x is called independent variable. Y is called dependent variable. Okay. All the input features are called independent variable. The y is called a dependent variable. So I could have hundreds of dimensions. I cannot show them to you on a piece of paper. You have to just envision it in your mind. So there is another question here. If I have output y as 1 to 10,000, will it be classification or regression? See, if it is a fairly contiguous distribution like 1 to 10,000. So let me just try to write it here. So the question is that what if there are, output values from 1 to 10,000, right? 1 to 10,000. So you can assume this is a very long distributed distribution, right? With too many possible values. So this would be represented best by a line chart. So this would be regression, okay? If there were 2 output classes, 0 and 1. 0 means do not issue bank loan, right? Do not issue bank loan, the customer is not credit worthy. Bank loan. So this is loan is sanctioned. two different classes. This is okay. 10 vehicles, cars, trucks, trains, buses, aeroplanes, right? Cycles. That is 10 possible classes. That's classification. If it is a long contiguous distribution, it is regression. If it is distinct classes, it is classification. I hope that is clear. So it is case to case. We have to look at the use case we are dealing with. All right. Let's continue here. Okay. So I just described to you how regression works and what we are trying to do. So what we said on the last slide was the blue dots are the input to the model training process. The equation of the red line is the output of my model training process. In traditional data analytics or software engineering, we would have to know the equation of the line. Y is equal to some function of x, whatever it is, right? We write a generalized equation in this form, y is equal to some function of x. So this is a general form of the linear equation. So in traditional analytics, I would need to know the equation and then I would predict the blue dots. In machine learning, the blue dots are the input, the equation is the output. It reverses on its head, okay? So machine learning is opposite of analytics in that sense, that here the equation is the output, not the input. All right. Now in machine learning, we use vectors to simplify stuff. Okay. Because this is vector notation. So this is W transpose vec. So these values, when I say y is equal to 3 x1 plus, let's say 10 x2. Right. So these values are called weights. In machine learning, we call them weights. If you remember from high school algebra days, we had something like y is equal to mx plus c, correct? Most of you might remember mx plus c. C was the y-intercept. Now we are calling it b or w0. So we may call it w0 here, or x0 or w0 or b, whatever. And this m was the slope. So m is the slope. So m is the rate of change of, what is m? M is rate of change of y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. That is m. In a differential notation, we'll write it as dy over dx, which is same as y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. Correct? This is the slope. Same way, x1, this 3 would be equal to dy over dx1. So dy over dx1 equates to 3. This 10 would be equal to dy over dx2 in the same way as the slope term. Okay. So this is the slope. This 10 is the slope with respect to x2 feature. 3 is the slope with respect to x1 feature. And this comes from linear algebra. So essentially, we haven't done anything new so far. All we are doing so far is revising your basic linear equation from your 10th grade maths. I haven't taught you anything new so far. I'm just merely asking you to recall your equation y is equal to mx plus c. All right. So machine learning is nothing but an application of your high school maths. So that's why in machine learning we have to revise our maths. Okay, for high school maths primarily. So now we also remember vectors and matrices from our high school or 12th grade, right? Or senior school. Or A level or whatever, right? So if you remember, we can write in vector notation. If you write in vector notation, this becomes w1 x1 plus w2 x2. Let's say there are only two features to consider. There could be 1,000 features for all we know, right? Finally, I will also have something called w0. This is the y-intercept or b. So b is nothing but w0. B and w0 are same, is the y-intercept. So shorthand notation, so W vector represents, what does W vector represent? It is the weight vector, we call it. W0, W1, W2, and so on. We can write this in vector notation. Then X represents the vector for input X features, X1, X2, and so on. And X0, of course, in the beginning, right? X0 is merely 1. So you can imagine there is a x0 multiplied here, which is equal to 1. x0 is hard coded to 1. So x0 is just nothing but 1. It's a constant. So this is 1. So it is basically, since this is 1, it is just equal to b, bias or y intercept. this is the vector notation for this expanded equation. And when you multiply two vectors, you have to take a transpose of one of them, as you know from vector multiplication, correct? So that's why we are showing a transpose over W. All right. So you cannot multiply two vectors directly unless you take a transpose. Okay. So as I said, I am still on your high school maths. I haven't taught you anything new. I'm merely revising your high school linear algebra. So this is the equation we have seen in high school and we are still using it. This is the basis of machine learning. Modern artificial intelligence is nothing but this equation. Quite a statement there, isn't it? This is artificial intelligence for you. We thought AI is something so hot. Well, it's nothing but high school maths at the end of the day. And we just do variations of this equation. That's all we do. So this is when I have only one input feature X. And this is when I have multiple X features. So let's say there were 1,000 input features. For example, trying to predict house prices. It cannot be one or two features which represent, stock prices, which represent stock prices, right? Share market. There will be thousands of factors. You can call them factors, features, input features, right? Input variables. You can call them anything. We use multiple terms for X features. So if there are thousands of input features, I cannot write W0 plus W1 X1 plus W2 X2 1,000 times. That's unwieldy, right? So we write stuff in vector notation for short form. Right? Hope this is clear. Let me continue here. Any questions? Feel free to ask. Okay, so there are different kinds of regression. Okay, this linear regression, multiple linear regression, polynomial. Okay, so linear regression is when there is only one input feature X. Multiple linear regression is when I have, let's say, at least two input features. Okay, and polynomial regression happens when the equation is not straight. See, sometimes the equation has a curvature, a parabolic relationship. Then what do you do? The linear equation will not work. In this case, it will be something like y is equal to 3x square. So if I square it, it becomes a parabola. So this is called a 2-degree polynomial because there is a power of 2. If it is x cube, by the way, then it is of this form. X to the power of 4, y is equal to 7x to the power of 4. Then it would be of this form. Okay. So, you know, when I say I'm doing machine learning, all I'm trying to do is determine the ideal weights. That's what we are trying to do. Because initially, we just know it is y is equal to w1 x1. So the process of machine learning model training is, the objective of machine learning model training is to find the ideal value of weight by looking at existing data. So whatever existing data is provided to me, these are existing data samples provided to me. So by looking at these data, we are trying to find the ideal value of weight. This is what we are doing in machine learning actually. So decision tree regression also accomplishes the same thing. It uses decision tree algorithm. Same with random forest and support vector machines. Okay. All right, let's continue here. So these are various regression techniques. Let's look at the very basic one. We covered most of it actually already. So we saw that one input variable, X, simple line fitment, straight line, by the way. Linear word means straight line. So it is straight line. Now notice something here, that the red line does not pass through blue dots. I wanted a line which satisfies the blue dots, isn't it? So I would, if I really want to do that, I would have to draw a line like a child and connect all the dots. Guess what? If I were to do this, I cannot derive the equation of the line. A haphazard cell line segments will not lead me to one simple equation of the line. So what I do, I take an approximation. So I say, well, the red line is approximately satisfying the blue dots. There is an error. It is not 100% accurate model because they are not passing through the blue dots, right? But we say 80% it's accurate. It's mostly passing near the blue dots, if not precisely on them. We compromise in machine learning. We compromise, we make do with approximate result. All right. So how do we measure the degree of error? So there is a degree of error, right? Because it's not passing to blue dots. What we do, we take a projection of all the blue dots on the we take a projection. So let's consider one single sample. Let's say this sample, right? So the sample is here, but if I were to apply the equation of the line will suggest the corresponding y lies here. Or let's say x, so this is, let's say 50, x is 50 here approximately, and y is 15 approximately. Let's assume y is 15 here. This is the real blue dot, okay? However, the red line seems to suggest that y is only 12, right? So red line seems to suggest y is only 12, whereas y is in reality is 15. There is an error. What is the error? What we do 15 minus 12, we square it. Plus, then we do the same thing with every other dot. We find the error, how far it is from the line, and we do a vertical projection. And the point on the line which is being predicted is on the line. So let's say my next one is 30 minus 28. I keep subtracting these vertical projections for every sample. I do it for all the samples like this. Then I put them in a bracket, all of them, divide by number of samples. This is what we call as mean square error, MSE, or sum of squared errors. This is called sum of squared errors, SSE, also sometimes called mean square error. Why mean? Because I am dividing by total number of samples, m. If there were 100 samples, m would be 100. I'm taking a projection and subtracting the length of that line, this length, this length, this length, and I'm squaring it. I'm adding all the squares for every dot projection, dividing by total number of samples. This is called mean square error. This is what mean square error is, a good indication of the degree of error the red line has with respect to the provided data samples. Okay, I hope this is clear. Let me check any questions. I see some questions here. All right, so let's continue here. Thanks for your kind words there. Appreciate it. Let's continue. All right. So now we look at, before we go to how we train a linear regression model, we will look at how to solve polynomial regression. So linear regression, we'll solve the way we solve it. We'll see that later. But meanwhile, first look at polynomial regression. So you can see here the data samples are such that they occur on a curvature line. Clearly, a straight line is not good enough here, correct? A linear equation is not so good. The degree of error would be very high, because even if I were to draw the projections, they are very far, right? I see a question here. Let me just address the question. The concept of variance and bias, what to keep low, what to keep high, completely depends on the application, correct? It is always suggested to keep high bias and low variance. Well, that is use case dependent. You can't just say that. So bias versus variance, I haven't explained for those of you who don't know it. Is cost function and MSE same? Yes, we'll come to that. We'll come to that. Kindly hold that thought. We'll discuss what is a cost function. MSE is the cost function in most cases. MSE is the cost function. Yes, let me come to that slowly. Slowly I'll come there. All right, bias versus variance I won't discuss here. That's a slightly different concept. But yes, it is applicable to all machine learning models. So, okay. So now this is polynomial regression. This is a better fit, as you can see, right? Now, how do we solve it? What we do feature transformation activity. So let's say there is a feature here. Notice this requires a square. So here, x1 has a linear relationship to y, but x2 has a polynomial relationship. It's a 2-degree polynomial because it's to the power of 2. What I do, I set x2 square simply equal to as x2 dash, okay? And substitute x2 dash here. So let me just clear this up. So what happened here is x2 square became x2 dash. So while x2 has a polynomial relationship to y, but the new transform feature, which is x2 dash, has only a linear relationship for y. Then I'm going to apply usual linear regression techniques on this equation, not on this equation. So once I find this model, then it would have found the corresponding, you know, relation to x2 squared. Okay, because w2 would have been found. So the way we solve polynomial regression is we do a transformation. We convert a polynomial feature into a linear, find the relationship with respect to the new feature, and then it would have found the feature with the original, the relationship with the original feature as well. Okay, this is what we do. So this helps us solve linear regression, polynomial regression. Let's continue here. Now we come to how to actually train a regression model. Okay, we discussed called the concept of cost function, which was asked. So there are two methods to solve linear regression or regression in general. So one is normal equation, the other is LMS or least mean square algorithm. Okay, let me continue here. We'll quickly look at normal equation. I won't spend a whole lot of time on this because main one is gradient descent, which is next one. So here somebody was asking cost function. Yes, mean square error, so which I described to you. What is mean square error? It is y2 y1 minus y1 dash predicted value by the line versus the real value square plus y2 minus y2 dash square. So I told you we'll take a differential, the projection of the dotted points on the line, and we'll sum them up, divide by total number of samples. N. This is called mean square error, correct? This is what is shown on the y-axis here. Mean square error. This is called the loss of. Okay. So we also know from our derivative days. See, we are still on high school maths. We have not discussed anything new. Artificial intelligence. All I have been discussing so far is a chapter from your high school maths book. So you will be amazed to learn that most of the AI is nothing but an extension of your high school maths. Okay, that is the beauty of it. I mean, that's true of engineering as well, I guess. All engineering is extension of high school maths in physics. So that's fine, I guess. Okay, so let me continue. So what is happening is, what we do, I told you that we are trying to find the ideal value for weights, right? So I'm just, for simplicity, I'm showing one feature. I want to find ideal value of weight. Let me go ahead and plot the loss function or the cost function, which is basically the error function, mean square error, with respect to weight. If so happens, this follows a convex shape, inverted parabola. Okay. So now notice something here, that I won't worry about this match. Don't feel daunted by this match. Once I explain it to you, it is a piece of cake. Just look at this chart with me, please, here. Just look at this chart. Don't worry about the math shown there. It is unnecessarily complex, but at the base of it, it's really a simple math. So what is happening here is that I am basically, if you remember, the slope of a horizontal line is what? Zero. If you remember, the slope of a horizontal line is zero. What is the slope of this line here? How can we represent it? D of MSE, as you know, dy over dx, right? So in this case, d of MSE over d of w. Differential of, so you can say y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. In this case, y is MSE, so dy over dx, so dmse over dw. This is the slope. I merely have to set the slope equal to zero, because the slope of the line at this point is zero. Why I'm interested in this point? Because here the error is minimized. Notice something here. If you notice here, the error is minimum possible error. After that, again, it takes a turn for the worse. So what we want to do is find this point. If we found this point, I found the minimum mean square error point. Minimum mean square error point found, I found my ideal weight. My ideal weight here is 1.5. So I would have discovered that the value of ideal weight is 1.5. Right? 1.5x. Once I discover the ideal weight, my problem is solved. I have trained my model. I can use this to predict future y for new future x values, right? All that I have to do is set d of MSE over d of w as 0. One more term we use for derivative operator is d of MSE or d of w. This delta sign, inverted delta d of MSE. This is nothing but equal to d of MSE with respect to D of W. Okay, they are same thing. What I am doing here is I am merely setting this to zero. This is called the gradient or the derivative or the gradient of the loss function with respect to weight W. And this is of course equal to D of MSE, the slope of that curve, the second curve, with respect to D of W. Now, what was MSE? Rest of the maths is nothing but an expansion of this equation. What was MSE? Remember, MSE was y minus y dash square divided by number of samples, summation over all samples. Remember, the projection difference from the actual samples on the straight line squared by summing them, I'm representing all the sum by summation sign, divided by number of samples m. This is what I am doing here. Y dash minus y square equal to zero. And what was y dash? Y dash was the prediction, right? Y dash is the prediction, which is the equation itself. I'm just substituting y dash with x w, which is the prediction, w into x, right? Y dash is w into x. This is the prediction of the model. This is the real y train is the real value. This is the predicted value, which is the y dash. Now I'm merely applying this kind of formula. Actually, maybe this is wrong. What I am applying is a minus b square. I'm applying this formula and I'm expanding this equation by applying. So this match tip I need to correct here really. It should be a minus b square. A minus b square is equal to a minus b, a plus b. Right? Yeah, so I'm applying this. So I'm squaring. So a minus b into a minus b. That's what it is. Sorry, yeah, this is the correct one. So a minus b square would be a minus b and a minus b again equal to zero. And then I'm merely expanding that. Okay. A minus b to the power of square is a square plus b square minus 2ab. Correct? This is a minus b square. This is the equation we have to use. A minus b square. This is again high school equation. Nothing new still. So this is what is the extension of that. And finally, I solve for w, the weight w. Everything comes to the right. This is what I get. So once you understand this equation, it is nothing but this equation, nothing else. It is shown in vector notation, so it looks complicated, but it's nothing but that equation. Okay, so this is the equation we are applying. This I have shown wrongly. This mat tip is not correct here. I need to fix that. All right. So I found my ideal weight, by the way. Notice here in the last line, I found my ideal weight. So if we were to represent this in very simple notation, we can do it like this. So the same equation represented more simply, the x vector, the input sample x features, dot x to the power of minus 1 into x vector again into y vector. These are provided data, right? Because I am given, let's say, 1000 data samples. So x will have 1000 x features, 1000 x values, y will have 1000 output y values. This is called normal equation. This helps me find ideal weight. However, there is a limitation. This only works for simple linear models. Okay, this only works for simple linear models. For more complex models, we have to do the next algorithm, which we look at now. Let me check some questions meanwhile. Is cost function and MSE same? Correct. Cost function, MSE, loss function, they mean the same thing. Okay. Now, sometimes in neural networks, we have other kinds of loss and cost function like cross entropy loss. But for most classic machine learning models, mean square error is the cost function or loss function. What x2 dash transformation has no relation with other variables when you change the x2 dash? Is that true? Changes to for one variable will have no impact on other variables. See, so we assume, see, I told you all the input x are independent variables. So we assume they are independent of each other. X1 and x2 are independent of each other. All right. So if x1 and x2 have a correlation, then we may have to do something called dimensionality reduction or covariance matrix. if x1 and x2 are correlated, then we may have to do something more funky called dimensionality reduction or covariance matrix and create a new feature which represents the joint impact. So we'll have to create a x3 feature which will be created by combining x1 and x2 so that I can capture the correlation between x1 and x2. Okay, so we assume in machine learning that input features are independent variables. They do not depend on each other. If there is a dependency, we create a correlation covariance matrix, and we may have to combine features in using dimensionality reduction or dimensionality upsampling mechanism. Okay, so I won't go there for now. Let's keep it simple. All right, so we already saw mean square error. So we already covered a lot of the ground which comes from next slides. So we saw y dash minus y squared. Again, let me remind you, what was this? This was merely the, for every sample, y dash. So predicted value happens to be on y dash, happens to be on the line. The real value, this is y, this is the corresponding y dash. Okay, this is y, this is the corresponding y dash. Okay, this is y, this is the corresponding y dash for every sample. So for every sample, I do y dash minus y, I square it, sum them for all such samples, then divide by total number of sample, called mean square error, also called sum of square errors. We refer to as this as cost function or loss function. And we try to minimize this MSE, the loss function or cost function, with respect to weights. At the lowest point, the ideal weights are found. Simple enough. Now let's look at one more technique, how to solve this. Slightly more complex technique. So I'm going to do some notation changes here. Now instead of W0, W1, I'm using theta0, theta1, theta2. And here you are showing two features, X1 and X2. This is a y-intercept, bias B or C. And here we are representing Y as H of X over theta. You can also represent it as F of X, function of X. Here I'm calling it H of X, same thing. And we can say this is with respect to weight theta matrix. Right, so this is also equal to theta vector transpose x vector, correct? Dot product of two vectors. So this we are showing here, and we can represent in summation notation also. All clear so far? And we'll put x0 equal to 1, so it's become theta0 into x0. x0 is hard coded as 1. This allows me to write it like this, right? And the j theta becomes my loss function, y dash minus y. See, this is y dash, right? So y dash minus y square, summation over all samples. Instead of dividing by m, number of samples, I'm dividing by 2. That will not matter much. We'll see that shortly. This equation is also called ordinary least square equation or mean square equation. Mean square equation or sum of, this is mean square error or sum of squared errors. So there are multiple terms we use for this. Okay, ordinary least square OLS equation also. So here the formula is simple. In this second technique, here we are still doing, so we have the loss or cost function on y-axis, we have the theta matrix represented here on the x-axis, the weight vector, right? This is my MSE, loss or cost function, SSE, OLS, whatever you want to call it. This is theta or W vector, and as we know, we are trying to arrive at this minimum loss minimum point, because here mean square error is minimized. This is the point where my ideal weights will be found. So whatever is the value of weights here is the ideal weight value. This theta or W represent the weight, right? So in this second technique, which we call as gradient descent algorithm, we start with arbitrary theta or arbitrary weight. Let's say we were to start here randomly. Then we do a tiny weight change. We check the error. Now error has come down a bit, right? This is lower than this value. We change the weight a little bit more, error has come down further. We change the weight a little bit more, error keeps going down. Finally, wherever the slope dj, remember j is MSE over d theta, becomes equal to 0, I stop adjusting weight. This process is called weight adjustment. The term we use is weight adjustment logic. I'm slowly adjusting the weights in tiny increments, if you notice. I'm increasing the weight. You notice I'm increasing the weight. So weights are actually increasing. So loss is decreasing, the weights are increasing. So by increasing the weights, I'm able to reduce the loss. And when do I know when to stop weight adjustment logic? When the slope of dg over dt theta becomes zero. Correct? This is called gradient descent algorithm. Why? Because this is a gradient I am descending. And I am descending, so it's called gradient descent. Gradient descent. Okay, let's see in the previous slide now. Hope that is clear. So this works for more complex models, unlike normal equation, which works for simple linear models. Okay. So here we are showing. Here we are showing the weight adjustment formula by how to adjust the weight. So I take original theta j. Let's say I was here. This was theta j. I have to adjust the weight, right? How, by what quantum I should adjust the weight? This is that quantum figure. Okay. This is the, we can also represent this as delta theta j. So this delta theta j is equal to, if you notice, alpha dg over d theta. We deliberately choose this expression. Why we choose this expression, I'll explain now. Because the advantage of choosing delta theta j like this, this point dg will become zero, right? Slope of this curve will become zero, correct? So this slope will become zero. So this whole expression will become zero. Theta j is equal to theta j. When this expression becomes zero, the algorithm will understand I have reached my ideal weight destination. That is the advantage of using this expression precisely. Because at the bottom point, this will become zero and the weight will stop adjusting. So when I calculate dj over d theta, right here, so I start with random weight here, I calculate dj over d theta, it has some value. I multiply by alpha, it gives me some value. Now notice something, this is gradient, reverse gradient, downward sloping gradient. You know what? The slope of a downward sloping curve is negative. And hence we see a negative sign there, because this expression is negative. What will negative into negative do? Become positive. Okay, that is the reason you see negative sign here. I told you weight is increasing this side. So why am I doing negative here? Because this is also negative. Negative into negative cancels out, it becomes positive, as you know. So actually this is increasing the weight. As a cumulative expression, this is increasing the weight, not decreasing the weight. Okay, so that's why the negative sign here. What is alpha? Alpha is the what we call as learning rate. Alpha is the learning rate. Okay, this is very important hyperparameter. In machine learning, we have certain parameters which are not trained weights, which are hard-coded by the data scientist, the machine learning developer. So you have to know what alpha you have to use. Typically, we use 0.1, 0.01, very small fraction value. Why we have alpha at all? Why alpha? The reason is, if I don't have alpha, my attention is, what if dj over d theta is very big? Guess what happens if I don't have alpha? And dj over d theta is very big here. So slope is very high here, right? So it will take a large jump. There's nothing to stop because dj over d theta is high. Now at this point also, dj over d theta is very high. It will take another large jump. Again, the dj over d theta is high, it will take a large jump. Guess what? I missed my loss minima. If I don't have a learning rate multiplier, my worry is that I will miss the global minima. This point is called loss minima or global loss minima. All right. We apply a fractional learning rate here so that we ensure the increments are only tiny. So that it will not miss the loss minimum point while it is jumping around. If I don't apply the learning rate, my fear is it might miss the loss minima and not converge to the minimum point. It will swing to the other side like a wild pendulum. So this is like a wild pendulum. If you push it too hard, it will swing to the other side, will miss the loss minimum point. To ensure we stop at the loss minimum point, we multiply by a fractional learning rate, small fraction like 0.01, so that we only allow tiny weight increments. Okay. By doing this, we are more guaranteed that it will stop here. It will not take a jump and suddenly go to the other side of the pond. Okay. I hope this is clear. Now, the rest of the mess might look difficult, but it's nothing but an expansion of this term dg over d theta. This is the only equation you have to worry about here. Now, what is so? This is the rest of mess. What is dg over d theta? Remember, y dash minus y square. Instead of 1 over m, I am dividing 1 over 2. And the property of the derivative is that it expands to this kind of thing, right? This is straight derivative. You are from your 11th grade. Now I am on your 11th grade math. In 11th grade, or you know, junior high, senior school, first level, we have learned our differential operator or integral operator. This is nothing but an extension of your differential operator. When you take a differential of this, this 2 will come here, and that is the reason we had 1 over 2. So this 2 over 2 will cancel, and then this will come out, and only this will remain. And when I take a derivative of this, what was h theta x? It was y dash, which was the prediction, which was theta vector x, right? When I take a derivative of x with respect to theta, so this will become merely x as we know it, correct? And this doesn't have the theta expression, so dy over d theta will become 0, right? So this became this, and this became this. And dy over d theta is 0. Okay, so this whole expression simplified to this term. So I substitute this here. This is what I get. This is my simplified weight adjustment equation. This is how I am going to adjust weights in FC every subsequent training iteration. So when I say I am doing multiple training iteration, in every iteration I am adjusting the weights. Multiple training steps. In machine learning, we have to train the model at 1,000 times. So we are running a model with 1,000 iterations, 1,000 steps. In each step, I'm applying this weight adjustment logic. Okay. Why I'm applying weight adjustment logic? So that my loss keeps falling, I can arrive at my minimum loss point. When I arrive at my minimum loss point, my ideal weights have been found. My model is now perfectly trained. And I found my equation which I was looking for, 1.5x in this chart. Now I can use this equation to predict future y for any new input x. So this is so fundamental to all of AI, okay? And all neural networks, most of machine learning is based on this kind of algorithm, okay? This is so fundamental. This we teach in our machine learning course. We have a training program, of course. So we teach this in machine learning course. This is very basic and a very fundamental machine learning algorithm. It's called gradient descent algorithm, a least mean square error algorithm. Why least mean square? Because I am trying to minimize mean square error. This is the mean square MSE, or J theta, I'm calling it here. So I'm trying to minimize mean square error. So least mean square algorithm. Okay. I hope this is clear. Let me take a pause here and address any questions you might have. Okay. Just a moment, please. Yeah. Okay. I see a question. So LMS implies least. Yes, that is correct. So LMS is the least mean square error. Okay. All right, so I don't see any questions, so let me continue here. All right, so as we said, we already discussed this. We start with initial random value of weight. We don't know initially where to start. You might now ask me, what if I started this side? Well, the slope of this point is what? It's positive, because this is a rising curve. A rising curve means a downside curve means slope is negative. A rising curve means slope is positive. So what would happen? Theta is equal to theta minus alpha dj. If I were to randomly start on the right of the loss minimum point, it doesn't matter whether I start from left, this expression will be negative. Negative into negative will become positive, so theta is increasing. Now if I were to randomly start on the right side of the loss minimum, let's say I were to start here, slope is positive here. So negative into positive is negative. So theta is equal to theta minus some positive value here. That means I am now reducing theta. You see, the equation will work on both sides of the pond. Even if I start here, it will be reducing the weight. I'll be jumping in this direction. If I start here, I'll be jumping in this direction by the nature of that equation. The equation will work in either case. Initially, I don't know what weight to start with. We start with initial random weights. So we run, let's say, 1,000 training iterations, 1,000 weight adjustment steps. Then we hope to find, within the 1,000 steps, we hope to find the loss minimum point. Okay, let's continue here. So we already sort of discussed this. So y dash, so now notice also something here. When I'm minimizing loss, what was loss? Loss was y minus y dash square. This was my loss expression, correct? Number of m divide by m or divide by 2, correct? And summation over all data samples. So when this loss is being minimized, what do I mean by that? That y is approaching y dash. This is what is happening, right? That means I'm trying to bring dots as close as possible to the line. I'm trying to find the line so that it is very close to the dots. That's how the y minus y dash, because this represents y, and the projected sample on the line represents y dash. So when I'm trying to minimize y minus y dash for every data sample, I'm trying to bring the line closest to the points. The more closer the line is to the dots, the more accurate the model is. And that is what we mean by minimizing the mean square error or the loss function or the cost function. Okay. So in other words, observed output approaches the expected output. The predicted output by the predicted by the line matches the known or expected output. Remember, I have historical data. I'm training this model on historical data. So I know the correct y, right? Okay, let's continue here. I hope that is clear. Now, learning rate matters. I already discussed this. If learning rate is too small, alpha, then I'm not allowing much weight adjustment. So it's taking forever to learn. It will learn, but it will take forever, right? Now, if the alpha is very high, let's say alpha is equal to 0.9, I allow large dj over d theta to change the weight. So you can see here, it is swinging widely, right? Like a wild pendulum. It's not converging to the loss point. Actually, I started with random weight here. Then I did a wild swing, went here, went here, went here. So instead of converging to loss point, it is diverging to higher degree of loss. So it is increasing on the cost or the loss. So that's why learning rate, optimum learning rate, is an expert decision a data scientist has to take. This learning rate alpha is called hyperparameter. In machine learning, we have very many hyperparameters which we have to tune. This is called tuning the model. Okay, tuning the neural network or tuning the model. Okay, so alpha typically we take as very small value, 0.01. We have to do hit and trial. There is no formula to know what is the correct hyperparameter. We don't know which of these is better. We have to do hit and trial. Okay, normally it's a small fraction. That's all we know. Okay, hyperparameters are found by experience and hit and trial. This is called tuning the model, tuning the hyperparameters. All right. Now, the loss function may have more complex shapes. It's not always so simple. So here we are showing a loss function which has two loss minimum points, here and here. Obviously, this is better because this loss is higher than this loss. Ideally, I would like to arrive here. This is called global loss minimum. This is called local loss minimum. Okay. So I don't know where to start the weight, right? Initially, we start with random weight. Let's say I started here. So the slope will become zero here. Weight will stop adjusting right here. So if I had kept going, I would have found a better oasis, right? But when I land here, the model doesn't know that. It just found slope is zero. It stops the adjusting the weight here. So we are stuck in local minima. This is called the problem of getting stuck in local minima. But we have no way of telling. So we take a compromise in machine learning. We say we are happy with local minima also, right? Right. So we have to sometimes we try to tune the model so that it will have velocity. So it will have velocity here, so it will skip the local minima and keep going in its quest for global minima. So we try to tune the model, so we will miss the local minima, okay? And we'll escape. It's called escaping the local minima and not getting trapped by the local minima. Sometimes we cannot solve it. Sometimes using certain tweaks or tuning parameters, we try to solve the problem of getting stuck in local minima so that we can hope to arrive at loss, global loss minima, which is a better, lower loss, lower cost. Okay, so that is one problem of local minima. Second problem is it might get stuck in a plateau. So here the loss function is pretty straight. Let's say we started with random weight here. We didn't know the ideal weight, so we started with random weight. Then it is stuck here for longer time. Ultimately, it will reach the loss minimum point, but after a long time, it's stuck in a plateau. So these kind of issues happen in machine learning. So how to solve this? This requires experience and expertise of the data scientist to try to solve these kind of issues. Okay. So that's why, you know, this does take some experience and training. This is not so easy, frankly. And that's why we say experienced data scientists, you know, they are valuable. Okay. So anyway, so let's say there's a use case here. So I'm trying to predict the longevity of cancer patients. So I could apply a regression model, right? So let's say I'm given 10,000 cancer patients and predict how much life is left. I can look at historical cancer patient data and develop a regression model. And using this model, then I can predict the longevity of future cancer patients, right? Here X would represent multiple features which influence cancer progression. For example, type and sensitivity, severity of cancer, weight, diet, strength, lifestyle, and mental health features, and so on, right? So there could be thousands of features which influence a dangerous disease like cancer, right? We have to account for all of them. That's why hospitals are now using, super machine learning algorithms and stats from Google or IBM Watson to try to do oncology predictions or cancer predictions, if you will. Okay, so that was some technical discussion on machine learning. Before I go to some career points on machine learning careers, do you have any questions on regression? We are already at top of the hour, but that's fine. We can go for another 15 minutes if you're okay. So you have any technical questions before I continue? Okay, let me continue here in that case. I'll discuss some career points, which I always do. So let's discuss some about careers in machine learning and data science. So the demand for data scientists is far, far outstripping the supply. And I think you might get a sense of why this is the case. Because data scientists do learn these kind of mathematical algorithms. Okay. So, and also we have to do Python programming or R programming on these algorithms. So it's a difficult, there's a steep learning curve. I mean, frankly, it's, as I said, it's high school maths, but it's a bit complicated, as you can see. So it takes some time. So that's why it takes about an year to train an intermediate level data scientist, about 1 year. Okay. There's no magic here. You cannot do a 1 month online course and become a machine learning engineer. Nobody can. Okay. It takes about 1 year of intense training and practice to train an intermediate machine learning expert. Okay. For world class ML expertise, you have to give it many years. I'm just talking about intermediate level ML expertise, after which you can actually apply for those lucrative interviews. The salaries for machine learning engineers in a city like Bangalore, India are, you know, touching a 1 crore and above. Okay. If you are deeply, deeply expert in machine learning, top tech companies in Bangalore will pay you 1 crore salary, 1 crore, 1.5 crore. In Silicon Valley, $1 million. Easy. Provided you can demonstrate substantial expertise. The keyword is substantial expertise. Okay. It's a difficult area. So there are not many people who have substantial expertise. Okay. These are for some possible career tracks. So we get questions from all kinds of people, not only technical and IT professionals, but also non-technical people. So if you can pick up Python programming again, Python is the dominant language we use in machine learning, not R or Java now. We use Python primarily. if you have done programming even in your high school days or engineering days, you can pick up again. Python is very easy to learn. Python programming is the easiest part here. The mathematical algorithm is the most difficult part that we teach people. So I tell people there are three kinds of technical data science tracks. If you don't want to do programming, you can learn Tableau, SPSS, Cognos, SAS, SAS, right? So this is reporting and visualization software for analytics and machine learning. Or you can be a big data engineer with Hadoop, Spark programming, Kafka, Hive, Apache, right? But the most glamorous, the most modern, and the most promising area is artificial intelligence, under which we cover machine learning, deep learning. Within that, you can specialize in predictive analytics, computer vision, text and speech, and NLP and chatbots, and you have it, and robotics, driverless car, and many other areas. Okay. Now, if you are not a technical person but still want to participate in the AI revolution, you can still learn and become an AI consultant or specialist. And we do training for functional managers in AI, and we don't teach them programming. We teach them the algorithms, and we use Microsoft Excel for some of the analytics. And we have B2B programs. Our training programs are primarily targeted for B2C, for technical track. For managers, we only do B2B training if needed. And we have trained solution consultants, program managers, QA, marketing managers, sales managers, and HR people in artificial intelligence. So all kinds of people can become AI specialists. Okay. All right, let me continue here. So this is our machine learning training program. So machine learning, we have the, this can be done from anywhere in the world. It's supported by pre-recorded videos, and we provide programming assignments in Python. So you check the video you check some notes, and then you do the attempt the Python programming assignment. You send it back to us. We'll give you a grade of ABC for every assignment you do. So we check each and every homework we give, and we give a grade of ABC. Our ML course is a 2-month course. Deep learning takes 2 to 3 months. And this can, by the way, these are self-paced courses. You can start anytime, okay, and take your time to finish it. But we recommend you do it in a timely fashion. Then AI internship is, we run a self-shared AI lab. You can be our intern. So this is our third course where we make you work on advanced AI projects. This is a 3 to 6 month program. As part of the AI lab, you work on advanced AI projects. Finally, we have something called research fellowship, which is similar to a mini PhD in machine learning. Here you have to write international research papers in portals like Archive or IEEE. Okay. And we say we create AI superstars. Our program is very intense. Very intense. It is not for weak of heart. Okay. So if you hate maths and you cannot pick up Python programming, we don't recommend getting into machine learning. Okay. So here, the first course gets you ML certificate, second deep learning, third one AI internship certificate. The combined program, the first three programs constitute what we call as PG certificate in artificial intelligence. So you can sign up for the integrated program, PG certificate in artificial intelligence. And you might have what it costs. So this is currently cost 6,000 rupees. Prices are subject to change anytime. 10,000 rupees. This is 20,000 rupees. Till March 30th, these are the prices. After 31st March, the prices are set to rise. Okay. From 1st April, prices will rise. So if you do the integrated program, it is available for 30,000. So there's some discount on the PG certificate compared to individual courses. It is available for 30K. All right. Let me continue here. And all through, you are part of our AI lab. And you can, every Saturday we meet, our AI lab group meets, and our remote members join through Hangout call, Google Hangout, and we discuss advanced AI algorithms in our AI lab every Saturday. Okay. All of our students are automatically member of our AI lab. Let me continue here. You can find all the details on our website, or just reach out to me and I'll be happy to discuss. This is a curriculum for our machine learning course. We actually review your maths. Optionally, we can also help you with pick up some Python skills if you have forgotten programming. Okay, so we review our maths, then supervised versus unsupervised, decision trees, regression, classification, intro to neural network. This is our machine learning course. Okay. let me come to deep learning course. So the right part of this represents the deep learning course. So this is our deep learning course. Okay. So here we teach neural networks, RNN, ANN, CNN. Okay. And then bit of natural language processing, bit of reinforcement learning and generative modeling. Okay. So this is, gets quite more, much more complicated. The deep learning courses are three times more difficult than the machine learning course. Neural networks are used here. They're very complicated algorithm compared to classic machine learning. So this is our AI lab. Our AI lab is working on almost 20 projects right now because we have got 70 researchers. So we are doing all kinds of models in computer vision, generation, NLP, predictive analytics, reinforcement learning, driverless cars, and looking at healthcare applications now, financial applications, and so on. So we run one of the most advanced AI research facilities in all of India. And even our members who are across the world join through the Google Hangout call every Saturday we meet. Okay. If you are in Bangalore, you can meet in person. This Saturday, I am doing AI lab meetup. If you are new to this, you are welcome to check out our AI lab this Saturday. All the details you can find on our meetup.com page where you found this webinar. This is one of the models our teams have developed. This is dense pose algorithm, which extracts the pose of a motion picture video. This can be used for augmented reality, VR, AR, VR applications, self-driving vehicles, cinematography, motion picture, advertising, gaming, fashion design. Companies like Amazon and Myntra are using these algorithms for their websites. Okay. This is an advanced computer vision algorithm which we are working on. This is object detection, which many of our lab teams have demonstrated. This can be used in e-commerce, smart retail, manufacturing, supply chain, FMCG industries, etc. Inventory management, demand forecasting, right? So tons and tons of application of this computer vision algorithm for detecting objects in an image. This is our lab meetups coming up. This Saturday, we have an AI lab meetup in Bengaluru. Okay, you are welcome to join if you are based in Bangalore. It's in South Bangalore. You can find all the details on our meetup page. Our next webinar for the global community is this coming Monday. One of our lab team leads in computer vision, Anshuman Das, will present neural style transfer, which is an advanced algorithm for style transfer technique in computer vision. Okay, you are welcome to join. Again, you can register on our meetup page. So both of these are open to the whole public. So if you are based in Bangalore, welcome on our Saturday meetup. If you are anywhere in the world, feel free to join our next webinar, which is on Monday. But this is an advanced computer vision webinar. If you are new to machine learning, you may have difficulty in understanding it. Okay. So before I do the demo of the code, let me address some of the questions which have come up. Could you please explain with an example when WX when vectorized becomes W transpose X? Okay, well, that's basic vector multiplication. Okay. When you multiply W dot product X in vectors, you have to take a transpose. You cannot multiply two vectors directly. That's just vector property. For that, I refer you to some lecture on vectors online. Okay. Just check out vector multiplication, how it is done. So it's about basic vector property. That's why you have to take a transpose. What a transpose means? So if I'm multiplying two vectors, W0, W1, just for simplicity, I'll show two only right now. Then X0, X1, right? This is W dot product X vector. I cannot multiply like that. I have to take a transpose of the weight vector, the first one. The, when I take a transpose, the row becomes a column and column becomes rows. That's how it works, right? This remains X0, X1. This is how we multiply vectors. Then this will be equal to W0. When we take a transpose, then this becomes equal to row becomes column, column becomes rows, right? This is basic vector property. W0 into X0 plus W1 into X1, okay? This is transpose property of vectors, dot product of vectors, okay? So you can look at vector online somewhere if you want further explanation. Leave it at that. Let me come to next question. If you are already aware of ML, can we join directly DL course? Absolutely. So you can reach out to me and I can help you join directly the deep learning course and after that the AI internship. Yes. If you know classic ML, you can directly go to the next level course. Okay. Just reach out to me. By the way, this is my information. You can take a photo of this. You can call me anytime or WhatsApp me or email me, whatever you prefer. I'm happy to discuss your AI career aspirations and advise you how we can go about your learning journey. All right. Any other questions before I go to the programming demo? So can I join the program from June, July onward? Absolutely. See, your programs are available all the time and they are self-paced. You can join now or you can join later. So there is no problem that there is a certain batch starting. These are self-paced. So these are pre-recorded videos. But that said, I do check all of your programming assignments, give you a grade of A, B, C. Okay. So see, the prices will keep rising. So if the question is after summer, price will rise. As the student community grows, the prices will keep rising. Okay. So price will keep rising. I cannot honor current prices after 3 months. I'm sorry. So if you want to, you can join the course now, but take your time to do it. But if you join it later, most likely the price would have risen. Okay, that we cannot help. Now there is a technical question here. Can the loss minimum be below theta axis? Well, I don't think so. I've never encountered or imagined a situation. So if this is my loss curve, cost function curve, I cannot imagine a situation like this. No, not at all. Loss will never become zero, right? Because what is the loss function? Y dash minus y squared. Number of samples, summation. See, maximum it can touch the point. It can touch. Ideally, we like it to touch. We like it to touch, right? This is the best case scenario. Loss has become zero. It is touching the theta axis. It cannot go down because notice this thing, y dash minus y squared, this will always be a zero or positive value. This expression will never be negative. It cannot go down. But if y dash is equal to y perfectly, all the dots happen to be on the fitted line. If y dash is equal to y for every sample, then this will touch here, right? This touching means this is the ideal weight here, whatever the value of it. So this touching the x-axis means that every y dash is equal to every y. That means all the samples are on the line. All the samples are on the line. That means y dash is equal to y for every sample, in which case the loss curve will touch the x-axis here, okay? It can never go below that. There is no way it can go below that. Okay. All right. I hope this is clear. Is there another question here? In terms of what is the registration amount I need to pay full time, you can reach out to me. We have some installment plans, but installment obviously costs more overall. So just reach out to me. We can discuss. Okay. So if you take installment plan, then it will cost more, obviously. But if you pay upfront, it costs lesser. So the prices I have shown you are upfront prices. If you want installment, it will cost more. That's the only difference. So you can pay monthly installments as well. That is possible, yes. So it costs more overall. So that's up to you. So you can reach out to me. We can discuss. All right. Any other questions before I go to the code demo? I know we are a bit over time. Okay, let me show you the code demo meanwhile. You can continue to ask any questions you might have. So I'll open my Jupyter notebook. We'll use a tool called Jupyter notebook here. Feel free to ask any questions meanwhile while I bring up my Jupyter notebook and show you a code demo for regression. Just starting my notebook now. So let's look at a basic linear regression. So here we are seeing a file. Let me show you the data set. We always deal with data sets here. So this is, I guess, house price regression. Okay, this is house price regression. The first column represents the X feature, which is the area of the house in square foot. And the second column represents the Y feature, which is the price of the house in US dollars, for example, right? So only one feature X, which is area in square foot, price of the house in USD, right? So here I'm reading this price CSV file into a pandas data frame. Pandas is a data manipulation library in Python. So I'm merely printing the X value. So however many input, this is square foot of the size of the house, as you know. So in machine learning, as you know, we split the data into training and test data set. So we can then test the trained model using some unseen data. So we reserve some data for testing. Here I am reserving 20% of the data for testing step. So I get X train, X Y, because this X and Y is available. So I get X train, X test, Y test, two different sets I get. Then I call a linear regression API, which is available in sklearn or scikit-learn Python library. And then I call a fit command. Fit means find ideal weights. It found the ideal weight, which is 36. That means Y is equal to 36.33X. This basically means the weight W is 36.33. Then I am trying to predict. So this is my trained model now, regressor agent. I'm trying to predict Y for the test samples. Then I'm taking error. I'm doing not doing mean square error. I'm just printing Y dash minus Y. This is Y minus Y dash, right? And I'm plotting. So when I plot on the training data itself, as you can see, it approximately satisfies the green dots, not perfectly. So we have to just make do with an approximate model, because trying to connect all the green dots will give me an impractical line. Then I superimpose the equation of the line on the test samples. These are test samples. So we can say, well, it satisfies the test samples to some degree, isn't it? Not very accurate, maybe around 70% accurate, right? So if I calculate mean square error, it will tell me the degree of error. Visually, we can look and say, well, the green dots are not online, so it's about 70% accurate, right? So broadly, it's okay, because probably we can't do any better the way this data set is, all right? So this was linear regression model training. Let's look at just one more, which is polynomial regression. So here I have an insurance premium predictor. If I were to show you the data set, I'm trying to predict insurance premium based on age of the person, predict insurance premium in Indian rupees. Okay, so X is age, Y is insurance premium. Okay, so again, I read the insurance.csv file using pandas data frame. I extract the first column X and second column Y. I train a linear regression model where there's some error here. I have to fix the error. Now I train a polynomial regression. So here you are saying I am using something called polynomial feature or quadratic feature. So I convert X into X square into X. This is the feature transformation. X is equal to X dash is equal to X square, right? So I convert. So I get a new feature, polymatrix, and I use that. So then I can simply apply linear regression, because this transform feature has a linear relationship, as we discussed before. Then we can train a linear model, okay, and then try to predict the output, okay. So if there was some error, it's not showing the output, I have to fix the error. In interest of time, I'll kind of stop here and take some questions, okay. In terms of what is possible on a full sense data science lines of projects, typically covering all aspects like Tableau with SQL or NoSQL, typical ML project, deep learning or research paper level. I'm not sure what is the question here. This is a long question, but I didn't get understood it. This is from Sridhar. I didn't understand your long question. Kindly ask again. Okay, what about grid CV techniques? Cross validation. Yes. So we can do cross validation techniques to find ideal hyperparameters or discover the correct model. Sometimes we don't want to guess the correct model, so we can use cross validation technique to find ideal hyperparameters as well as compare the results of different models so that we can discover the final model in one shot without hit and trial. Okay. Does the ipynb file run in normal Python IDE? No. .py file will run in Eclipse or PyCharm or Spider or Atom. So the traditional IDE we are used to is Eclipse, and in Python we use PyCharm, Spider or Atom as well. We can also use Eclipse with Python plugin. But Jupyter Notebook ipynb file will not run in those IDEs. It will only run in Jupyter Notebook. The advantage of Jupyter Notebooks is that you can execute cell by cell and it's very intuitive. So it is highly recommended. Most data scientists prefer Jupyter Notebook. Only when we get to very large and complex models, then we don't do Jupyter Notebooks. We just do plain .py file in a editor like PyCharm or Spider. Okay. Any other questions? So any final questions for today? So as I said, you can see my contact information. Just reach out to me and happy to discuss with you. Oh, well, there's a question whether do we do projects in Tableau or Hadoop? No. See, we specialize in artificial intelligence and machine learning. So we don't address other areas like big data or Tableau or even blockchain or others. We specialize in AI. If there is an application of AI in Tableau or AR, VR or blockchain, we can address it. But our focus remains on machine learning, deep learning, which is an infinite area. I mean, one lifetime is not enough to learn machine learning. Okay. Machine learning has, you know, tens of thousands of algorithms. And there are new research being done, new research papers being published every day, which are improving on the algorithms for computer vision, predictive inference, natural language processing, driverless cars, and so on. And now they have quantum computing, quantum neural networks. So this area itself will consume rest of our life. We will not get time to look at other areas like Tableau or blockchain or others. Okay. Any other final questions? So Tableau is only up till a certain point. Beyond a certain point, you have to get into machine learning. Tableau is a reporting and visualization tool, very powerful tool for that. However, even Tableau folks are now learning machine learning, because after a while, you have to get into machine learning. Okay, Tableau can only do so much. Okay, any other final questions? Okay, I am not seeing any final questions. So going once, going twice. All right. So, okay. So in that case, you all have a very good day. Or, okay, there's a question here. How different is Tableau from Python visualization? See, Tableau is a ready-made tool, right? So it might do what it does. But Python visualization, you can do, it's a programming concept, right? So you can program anything, right? Even Tableau internally might be using Python visualizer tools, right? Tableau is an end user tool. With Python visualization algorithms, you can visualize anything. There are like unlimited visualization possible. Okay. Any other questions? All right, so thanks for your time. Thanks for your intuitive questions. I hope to see you in the next webinar. Thank you. Have a very good night or a good day, as the case may be. See you next time. Bye for now.